Hey, this episode contains some adult discussions about sexuality and some swear words. So if that's not for you, then you probably want to skip it. Welcome to the I Don't Do That podcast, where we get into all the things that we're not into.
Na 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 na, yeah, no, I don't do that, no, I don't do that. No, it's all right, you can ask, but I don't do that. No, I don't do that. I don't do that. I don't do that.
Episode 8.
I'm very interested in having like a deeply loving relationship with someone that I'm like sexually, romantically, emotionally connected to. Basically all of the same aspects of what people are typically looking for in like a long-term monogamous relationship, but I just have absolutely no interest in exclusivity.
Episode 8 is I Don't Do Monogamy. We're talking with Seth, who is non-monogamous. Seth is a man in his late 20s. He identifies himself as white and lives in Minneapolis, Minnesota, USA. He is the drummer for the band Lavender Daughter. Seth, I'm looking forward to the discussion we have ahead of us.
All right, lay it on me.
So you say, do you say non-monogamous or do you say polyamorous, or is there a word you prefer?
So yeah, so non-monogamous is essentially like the blanket term, like the umbrella term, if you will.
Okay.
Not like ethical non-monogamy, in general, very broadly refers to any sort of like kind of relationship anarchist situation where it could be any sort of like sexual or intimate or loving or romantic situation, you know, but with like, it's not limited or exclusive to one partner.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas polyamory more specifically is having multiple like loving relationships at one time.
Okay.
So it's a little more specific than, and non-monogamy is kind of the more broad term.
Right,
you know?
Right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So do you consider yourself polyamorous then in that umbrella, or is it broader than that for you?
Polyamory is something I aspire to.
I see.
I am in one loving relationship right now with, you know, Lola Red, my bandmate from Lavender Daughter. They are one of my partners and have been for several years now.
Uh-huh.
And our relationship is kind of its own thing. we've always kind of considered each other like cosmic mates, if you will.
Yeah.
Life partners, you
know?
Yeah,
yeah.
Just because we kind of just have a really special sort of unheard of intimacy.
Mm-hmm. You seem like great friends too.
Yeah, yeah, we are. Yeah. We started out as great friends. You know, I remember us being instantly drawn to each other at orientation night of our very first night of college at McNally Smith.
I see.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's even like this moment we both remember where we both turned at the same time and made eye contact, and there was just something there, you know.
Uh-huh.
It was kind of cool. But at the moment, I don't have any other long-term loving relationships, and I haven't even really since I came out as non-monogamous in 2018, like publicly.
Uh-huh.
I've always kind of felt this way, but Lola was the one who came out first, and they really kind of helped me find my footing and definition with it.
Okay.
And really come into that. But I...
So kind of a guide or someone to come first a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. And I really admired how just like kind of out and proud they were about being non-monogamous and being kinky and,
sure,
you know, just wanting to date and love and fuck lots of different people. And
yeah.
I'm like, I feel like I've always felt that way, but I've always kind of been stepped on whenever I brought it up.
Sure.
Especially, you know, think about like where I was born and raised. I mean,
yeah,
you know, that just like non-monogamy is probably kind of an unheard of thing down there.
Do you feel like left out of conversations about inclusiveness?
Absolutely. You know, I think that just given situations in the past, like people have told me, you know, like, oh, well, either like this is a phase, something you'll grow out of, you're just young and dumb, or like, all the way to the other side where it's like, this is like offensive. You try like verbatim, you try people on like clothing, like it's insulting what you do to these partners of yours. And it's kind of, and again, like, you know, culturally in the United States, we're a very monogamous centered, you know, family oriented country, right? You're encouraged to like have a, like a, you know, like a very heteronormative binary mother father situation to raise children, right? For the next generation or whatever. So, you know, similar to things like homosexuality, I would say it's not really as welcome because it doesn't really fit that format, nor does it kind of help push that agenda along, if I'm, you know, getting a little more technical. But like, yeah, to answer your question, I've definitely felt like dismissed and left out of the conversation. And I also, just from what I know from experience, especially in the Midwest, Minneapolis is not bad, but it's a lot less commonplace in the Midwest, obviously. And friends that I have that live on either coast, you know, New York City or Seattle or Los Angeles, they're always telling me, like, there's lots of non-monogamous people out here. It's much more commonplace than when I'm back home in Minnesota or traveling to Minnesota. And that's something I think about, too.
They don't have to explain it to everybody who finds out. And
exactly.
Or like on a podcast and to tell everyone what it's about.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Or, like, you know, even, like, things like going on Tinder, right? I have very little luck on Tinder unless I'm willing to compromise my values, which I'm not. So, you know, a lot of times a pitfall that I run into with dating people is, like, they're interested, et cetera, et cetera. And then, like, first date or even before we get together, I'll let them know, just, you know, I'm non-monogamous. And they're just like, oh, well, then this is over.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
So I haven't done, like, dating apps. Does Tinder allow you to identify yourself like that on a profile?
There's not, like, an official thing you can put on there, you know, like, where you can, like, your sex or your age,
or your orientation, I assume.
Right. But you can put it in your bio, but that's about all you can really do, you know? And, like, most people on Tinder, from my experience, are looking to get married as quickly as possible.
Really?
Yeah. It's like the most common thing I see in people's bio is, like, in all caps, not looking for a hookup, right? Like, i.e., or looking for something real, which I think that's a problematic statement to begin with, because any relationship can be real. A relationship does not become reality when it's, like, boxed within a certain set of terms or, like, conditions, you know, but
yeah, I suppose in some way that's somebody saying that what you're doing is not real.
Yes. And it's frustrating because, like, you can still have the exact same loving, even, like, in some ways, emotionally exclusive kind of relationship you can in a monogamous setting, but with multiple people. And to me, it's very much like having lots of different friends, you know, like, I'm not your only friend and vice versa, but you and I have, like, a specific kind of relationship, and we get things from one another that we don't with other people.
Right.
The only difference is we're not fucking, you know,
right.
Like, so I don't really see why there has to be any difference. It can truly be a parallel, you know,
yeah,
like with loving or sexual or intimate relationships.
Yeah. 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 I don't either. I know that it isn't for me. But some of the reason I might shy away from, like, a non-monogamous situation would be that it seems like a pain in the ass. Is it a hassle to, like, to maintain relationships with multiple people?
It can be, yeah. And that's why I think it's very important to talk about what kind of relationship you want to have early on, like, what your expectations are, you know? Because, like, one thing you'll notice with, like, typical monogamous structures is kind of like expectations that are built into the relationship, right? We say good morning, we check on each other daily, we text each other throughout the day, we see each other, but we prioritize each other more than most things, right?
Yeah.
Like personal time or time with friends, like, and through the lens of relationship anarchy, it never has to be that way if you don't want it to be. So one thing I'm very upfront about with my partners is, hey, I want to hang out, like, maybe no more than once a week, possibly even, like, twice or once every 2 weeks or something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't text back that often. I don't want to text daily or whatever. Like, these are, and, you know, if it vibes with them, it does. And if not, that's fine. We just got to go our separate ways. And, like, so that's kind of how I manage having multiple partners at once, is, like, setting those terms that I'm comfortable with, you know, like, I sure as hell could not, like, have, like, be dating six people at once and doing it, like, the typical, like, way that you're expected to, you know, kind of like the Disney Channel love or whatever you want to say.
But,
like,
yeah, I hear you.
Yeah. And really it all comes down to, like, how much time you want to invest in your relationships with people and how you want to structure them, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And sometimes, like, you know, and for example, like, maybe some non-monogamous folks, it can even be as, like, you probably heard the term open relationship more than anything, right?
Sure, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, where, like, maybe you have one primary partner, let's say, and then, but you both have an agreement that, like, let's say I'm on the road for business or I'm at a bar and we hook up with someone and we fuck, or we just casually fuck somebody on the side or whatever. Like, it can be, that's the thing. It can be, like, a myriad of different kinds of relationship structures that can help curb that very issue,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So I'm curious about, like, what has worked for you, if you don't mind. So do you consider Lola to be a primary partner since you've been together, or is it still just sort of a myriad of partners and they just happen to be one who's been with you for a long time?
Yeah, well, I guess I consider Lola more of a life partner, and
okay.
Our relationship is like, it's like, so Lola right now, I believe that they have four long-term relationships. So there's me, and then they're seeing three other people. but there's a slight difference in like kind of the things they get up to with their other partners versus me. We consider each other more of like, again, like the term, when I go back to like life partners and cosmic mates, it's a little bit more ethereal, if you will, right?
Sure.
And in a way, I guess you could consider it primary partnership, but like we live together. We don't like do like things like date nights or things like that, you know, like, or maybe like where like they might be doing that more typically with these other partners. But we are in our relationship structure, we create music intimately, or like we'll like enjoy media together, or like talk about art, or just spend time together, travel together, you know, like so it's a little atypical in terms of like what you'd normally expect from a relationship. But again, that's like through the relationship anarchist lens, where they and I have set up those conditions ourselves, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, so I guess you could even say like ours is like perhaps less romantic and more intimate and more interpretable. Like interpretive way, I suppose, you know?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It sounds like what you have is specific to your relationship.
Yes, most definitely.
And mm-hmm. So it vibes differently than like a rom-com sort of.
Yeah. Like we're not going to Red Lobster once a week for date night, but like we'll make time to like cuddle on the couch and watch movies together, you know, or like we'll songwrite together, or like when we're playing on stage together or on the road, like you could consider that like, you know, us immersing ourselves or spending time with one another, you know, as partners.
Yeah. So as far as you two, what would happen? So in a fictional sense, in a hypothetical way, what would happen between you two where you would say, this is everyone else, but not us? Do you know what I'm saying? What if you did it, like, so you went to Red Lobster or something, like, what if you did it would be totally out of character? That would be in character for couples, right?
Oh,
traditional like, couples.
So you're saying something that we don't do that others would?
Yeah.
Oh, I guess, like, things like, you could even say like, you know, sending good morning or good night texts, you know, or like feeling obligated to check in with each other daily because that's what we do, or making sure 3 or 4 days out of the week are spent with each other because we're a couple, or even in the sense of like, you know, like a lot of relationships are escalator style. That's what they're called, where it's like,
okay,
you're constantly, there's it's goal oriented.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, like,
sure.
What are questions like, what are we or what are we doing? Like Lola and I are asking these questions like for the future. Fuck it. We'll just keep doing what we're doing until we die. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's not like, what's this going to turn into? Are we going to talk about, you know, marriage or children or fostering a home together someday? You know, it's like, it's just, we're comfortable doing what we're doing and we don't have our sights set on any sort of like end life goal kind of thing, you know.
And I assume it still goes places.
Absolutely.
Because you're people changing, you're evolving human beings.
Yeah.
Can you tell me, like, is it different? Do you feel like the nature of your relationship is different than it used to be years ago or anything?
Yeah, definitely. You know, like when we first started hanging out, it was a little more just kind of like, we're buddies that make music together. Yeah. But like, you know, we've lived through so much together and seen so much together, and Lola and I have connected more deeply than almost anyone I know.
Yeah.
That itself has kind of attained this like really unique comfortability with one another, you know?
Sure.
Like this truly unique intimacy. And, you know, not to mention all the ways that they've helped me come out of my shell and really embrace who I am. But yeah, I would say that it there is even still kind of that escalator aspect of it, you know. It's just less tangible, if you will. Less tangible things like, oh, well, you got a house together, you have children together, you've given each other rings, you know. Whereas it's more like
you don't know what's on the next floor.
Yeah.
The escalator's going to some floor that you haven't been to.
And it's a thrill, right?
And who knows what department it is.
Yeah, exactly, man. Yeah. It could be anything.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's what I would say to that.
That's amazing. It sounds like you have something really special. And I, you know, I kind of wondered like, what are they, you know, with you two, but, the answer was, well, it's none of my business unless one of them wants to tell me.
No, it's true, but I'm happy to tell you because I love you. But yeah. And I think a lot of people do wonder, you know, like, I'm sure people that don't know us make their range of assumptions, but I also feel like that's human to do so. So it's whatever, but I kind of like that. It's, ill-defined, if you will. You know, I like there being a little bit of like a mythos to it, if you kind of will, you know, like.
Sure.
And that's the thing. We're very comfortable with each other. Like, even if we do, at times I know that both Lola, like, you know, there have been times when I've seen them cuddling on the same couch they and I cuddle on with another partner, and I'm chilling on the chair, and I'll feel jealousy, you know, but like,
sure,
I know I'm at a place where I handle it in a healthy manner.
Mm-hmm.
Take a step back and I'm like, okay, where is this coming from? Is this justifiable? Most likely not. Let's just like identify what's causing these feelings. It's just, you know, like this primitive feeling of like, oh, this person I love that I do the same thing with, I'm just witnessing him doing it. And I know that it happens with them and me too and other partners, but I know that we're both very good at identifying it and kind of putting the kibosh on it when need be. But I mean,
so
those,
you consider that like, well, this is something I need to work on with myself right now. Like,
yes, absolutely. Whereas I'll find that most people kind of just take their jealousy and run with it. You know?
Yeah. I mean, that's the kind you hear about.
Yeah.
You wouldn't to defend jealousy in some way, like you wouldn't hear about it if people were, or people are largely doing what we're talking about, like using it as an opportunity to work on yourself. You don't notice it then because it's silent.
Right.
You notice the jealousy when someone's throwing plates against the wall and that kind of thing. And
yes,
screaming
exactly
at somebody and waving their finger and accusing them of things. But who knows? There might be more silent jealousy and like healthy, you know, in a healthy way. Like this is because it's a natural thing to happen to you. And use it as an opportunity to work on yourself. And there might be more of that you just don't see.
Yeah, sure. But like, you know, thankfully, like even if they were experiencing jealousy, I wouldn't blame them at all.
Uh-huh.
And I'm sure vice versa. But like, so far, so good in terms of our relationship. I mean, like, you know, they, you know, for the most part, handle it in a healthy way. Yeah. And I'd say I do the same thing. But it still happens, you know. For the most part, the opposite of that is compersion. Are you familiar with that term?
No.
That's like feeling genuine like joy and pleasure at seeing your partner enjoying themselves with somebody else.
Sure.
I would say that I experience that more often than jealousy, you know? And like, because I think Lola and I are at this like place where we're just like, yeah, we're not monogamous. There's no question about it. We're not dipping our toe in the water. We are immersed in the pool.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so we really get down with it, we understand it, and so compersion is the thing that I feel, at least, you know, that I feel that the two of us probably feel more so than jealousy, but
sure,
both will happen. But yeah, I mean, there's other things like, and it's, I feel like a lot of it has to do with conditioning, you know, like things that have been pounded into my head since I was young, like you know, I mean, aside from Lola, I've had like some like, you know, lighter relationships with people that I mean, I was hanging out with somebody who just moved to Hollywood, you know, like today, and they were really, really cool. It was our relationship was like a little bit less defined, but we were seeing each other consistently for a few months. And, you know, like, I mean, there'd be little things that I consider to be unfair on my end where like maybe I'd. And I catch myself instantly, but like you could see like whether it's with her or like other people that I've been seeing in the last like year or two, like maybe they post a picture of them with like some attractive looking person on their Instagram story. And I can't help but wonder like, oh man, like, oh, are they having a really good time together? Like better time than when we're together, you know, and it happens. You can't really help it. But thankfully at this point, it's like, I'm like, even so, doesn't matter. Like, let's say even if they're getting the best fucking sex of their life, or they're having like the most romantic fucking time of their life with somebody else, like, so be it. Again, like compersion, you know, like, and they still want to see me, they still want to spend time with me, and even if they didn't, so be it, you know, like, that's the thing. It's like, I feel like the reason people act on jealousy so viciously generally is because they're like, they're afraid of that situation happening. Like, no, you can't go to the club with your friends, because what if you meet someone there who is like a sexual competitor?
Yeah.
You're attracted to them. They fuck you better. And then you ultimately leave me for this person. But that's the thing. You've got to live and let live. You know, I mean, if that happens, that fucking happens.
Yeah.
Too bad. You know,
it does seem like a possibility, like that could be a reason for jealousy. I was thinking of that, too, as like, has anyone tried to turn you or claim you as their own and get you to be monogamous?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Many times.
Okay.
And there've also been a lot of situations where like, I will, let's say I go on a date with somebody and I am always upfront about it.
Yeah,
you know, it's never a secret. And they'll be like, well, I've never tried it before, but essentially I'll try it for you because I'm attracted to you. And I'm like, that's cool.
Yeah.
More often than not, it crashes and burns.
Sure.
Like we get like 3 months in, and the reality of the non-monogamy sets in, like, hey, I have another partner, or I'm seeing this thing where it's very casual for me. To them, it's like earth shattering, right? Wait, what the fuck? This doesn't make sense. This isn't what I read in my Disney storybook as a child, but like,
it seems like, you kind of have to do it for yourself. It has to be you.
Yes.
The non-monogamy has to be you, first. You can't really do it for somebody else.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that you have to have like a certain set of values or a certain mindset on life. Cause like a lot of people I know are concerned with their biological clock. They're concerned with external social pressures. They're concerned with dying alone. And a lot of these things are more likely if you're non-monogamous, right? As opposed to like the emotional security of like, or even legal emotional security of like getting married to somebody, you know?
Yeah. I mean, there's all kinds of things, right? There's like being perceived as a slut if you're mm-hmm. non-monogamous.
Which happens to me often. Yeah.
Stigma. Like the legal part that you said and the sort of the stability part. I feel like there's some kind of tactical advantage that I have, like being with the same woman that I've been with for like 10 years, you know,
mm-hmm.
like we have a battle plan of how we're going to like navigate this, war zone of life, you know.
Yeah.
It's a very violent metaphor, but like sometimes life is out to get you. Like that's why people want stability.
Yeah, totally.
You know? So like it isn't easy to make it and to like reach whatever your goals are.
And yeah. And like in my situation, man, kind of to bounce off what you were saying, like I'm very interested in having like a deeply loving relationship, like with someone that I'm like, you know, sexually, romantically, emotionally, you know, attached is not the right word, but like connected to, there we go. You know, like basically all of the same aspects of like what people are typically looking for in like a long-term monogamous relationship. But I just have absolutely no interest in exclusivity. You know, like I want both my partner and I to have the option of like sexually and emotionally exploring situations with other people. And the idea of exclusivity feels kind of like a prison to me. You know, it'd be like if someone told me I could only have one friend, you know. And if I didn't, I was a scumbag. And like honorable people aspire to having one friend, you know, like.
Yeah. And for you, exclusivity refers to sexual or physical or affectionate exclusivity. Is that?
Yeah. That primarily, but even like emotional exclusivity, you know, because sure. I feel like that kind of bleeds into things like, again, very heteronormative, very binary, but like, and people are like, who is this man you're talking to? You know, like when you're, let's say you're hetero and you're dating a woman or something, like, go ahead and talk to any female friends you want. Cause A, homosexuality doesn't exist in this person's mind. And B, they're just kind of a jealous person, but it's like, right, right. I think that's kind of what it, you know, bleeds into is like, just kind of, it just kind of comes down to like possession and control. And again, this is mm-hmm. not across the board from an all monogamous situation because some are handled very healthily
mm-hmm.
and the autonomy and agency is respected amongst partners. But a lot of times it isn't, you know, a lot of times people like the idea of like, I control this person. I'm not letting this person get away. I have them now. Like, you know, it's kind of like an extension of just like property ownership.
Sure. I mean, I don't know that much about non-monogamous relationships, but I could see them having problems too, and about people being manipulative and lying and
absolutely
having it wouldn't be the same, but of them also being bad for you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So. No. Yeah. Same thing, man. I mean, like that kind of stuff is not exclusive to monogamous situations by any means, but I think the key difference I look at it there is like there's like all these built-in expectations of like the American relationship, if you will, right? Where if you're in a like relationship anarchist situation, then there's more room for like, okay, well, there is some interpretability here. There is some like openness. Like it's not so like you should have known better. It's more just like, oh, this is something I'm experiencing or feeling, right? But there, I mean, there's definitely people that take advantage of folks and like are just deceptive and manipulative and slimy with their non-monogamy, or like using it as a way to just have lots of sex or to get things out of people, you know, like, I don't mean to paint non-monogamous people as this like across the board angelic, you know, divine entity, but like they're fallible and, you know, mistake prone.
You probably have to be careful, just like, it would, mm-hmm. yeah. Like,
yeah, absolutely. I think there's just like, there's toxic monogamous traits that like, what bothers me is just the built-in expectation of you should do this, you shouldn't do this. Mm-hmm. That bothers the hell out of me. Mm-hmm. So like, even though non-monogamous relationships are still prone to fallibility and things like that, at least there isn't, like, if you announce yourself as a relationship anarchist and you're dating someone who says the same, there can't be this like, oh, well, you should have known better. You should have known to do this. Like, you know, you should have come with me to that wedding function. It was cool, not cool of you to not go because like, that's what couples do kind of thing, you know?
Yeah.
Those things, you know?
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Well, that, it sounds like art to me, you know, I like art where it's like, wow, what is that? You know, to me, that's art. If I experience something that was created intentionally and I don't really, you know, I got to think about it for a second. It surprises me a little bit and mm-hmm. I got to spend some time with it to figure it out. To me, that's some art.
Yeah.
You know, but that's different than like learning how to paint a portrait or a basket of fruit with oil paints. And you can do it your own way and you're going to develop your own style no matter what, but trying to replicate something according to some set of rules or studying to create a particular type of art that someone else invented. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So like, but yeah, it's like, it's some groundbreaking shit and it's your own, it comes from within you as an individual. It's a very like individualistic thing. And the other people as individuals as well. Like, that's fascinating as hell to me. Like, because there's so many possibilities to it.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you meet somebody who's also on board with the same things you are, I mean, it can be a really beautiful, just kind of blossoming floral thing, you know, just like, and there's something so amazing to me about like that idea of compersion, you know, like, you love this person. You aren't questioning their love for you. You feel safe and secure in that, but you can also watch them do the exact same things they do with you and know that it's just like everyone's having a good time and enjoying each other. You know, it's like, I think that's a really beautiful thing. I think it's a hard concept for at least, you know, folks in the West to wrap their heads around. And I get it because we're a very monogamous culture, but like, yeah, to me, it's just like having lots of different friends and you're all hanging out together and you're all high-fiving each other and hugging each other and chilling at the barbecue, like whatever. It's the same thing. It's just slight differences, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. So I did want to get to some concrete things like
sure.
how it started, because I assume you grew up with the Disney movies.
Yes.
So you had the same concept starting out. Like with me, it was like the soft rock ballads of the 80s. Yeah. So
yeah.
Yeah. You get this idea of like what romance is supposed to be. And it's with one other person and it involves like sacrificing a lot and so on. And like,
yes.
Yeah. So what happened?
Well, I think I can trace it back to, you know, like when my earlier high school days, like I've always been a very sexual person. I've always been like sex positive and, I felt no need to slut shame people or like come down on people for wanting to have sex with lots of people. And I know that a lot of folks I grew up around did. And I remember dating this person in particular in high school, just kind of like a long-term girlfriend. And it was a loving relationship and my very first close one. But I remember at that time just kind of getting a distaste for like things that were expected of you in those relationships. Like, fuck, I'm an asshole because I didn't text you today. Like, I was busy, you know, like or whatever. Like, shit. Or like, you found a picture of a woman in my phone and now I'm in the doghouse. Like, what is that? You know, like, whatever. And the thing was like, I would never cheat on people. I never thought that was cool. I don't condone that by any means. But like, I was like, I started thinking like, is it really so wrong of me to want to have sex with lots of different people? Like, I just want to have sex and but also not just fuck, but like get to know these people and enjoy their presence and like kind of like dig them or love them as a person. But also it's like, you know, we're having healthy sexual and emotional relationships, but you know, that was, the seed was planted at a young age, but I would say up through like, you know, till 2017, 2018. My last monogamous relationship was in 2016. And, you know, she's very sweet and like on paper, it's in like a good relationship, but that was kind of the final piece where I was like, you know, I really don't think I can do relationships like this anymore. It's just, it's not really catering to who I feel like I genuinely am. And then in the subsequent years, that's when I, was meeting more people, like in the non-monogamous community, and Lola really came out as non-monogamous because they also had like one last big monogamous relationship. And I think they and I kind of came into that at a similar time and really helped each other out with that. They especially and me. But that's in terms of origins of that, that's what I can think of, is like always being very interested in like especially sex and also not feeling ashamed of it while being surrounded by people who would regularly shame others for it, you know, like good people. Had a partner they were loyal to and obedient to and only had sex under the right circumstances. There was a proper and respectable way to do it. I just think that's bullshit, you know? Like, to some degree, I think we're fucking animals and we should just have sex if we want to. And I'm as much as I'm into, like, promoting non-monogamy, I'm also into promoting sex positivity, you know? Like, everybody wants to fuck, and a lot of people I know probably at heart are non-monogamous people but decide to cheat instead of, like, do it ethically. And I've seen it happen. Maybe a lot of people is wrong, but I've seen it happen a lot of times, and it's really frustrating because it's like, well, they want the option to have sex with other people, even though they probably do really love this person, but it's one or the other. So then they end up just trying to get away with it unethically, and sure. It just makes things worse.
I definitely see that as a thing that happens. Like if you're just going to cheat, like let's just be honest about who we are and start from there.
Absolutely. Yeah.
This whole show is about a diversity of human beings. So like, I do think that probably the traditional way is for a lot of people. And I would call it it's like a cultural norm. But we're a multicultural society, are we not? So I don't see any reason why it has to be the only way.
Yeah.
I do think it like that it, some people, it works well for them. I also think, yeah, there are people like you're saying, for whom like it actually doesn't work and they keep trying it.
Right. And that's where I think that attitude becomes kind of pernicious, because I agree that like a lot of people truly are like they do want monogamous. I don't think that everyone secretly is actually non-monogamous and we're all lying to ourselves. I think a lot of people truly do like work well in a monogamous setting, and like they can do that in a very healthy way till the day they die. I've seen it happen, you know, but I think that because there's so much external pressure to be like, this is the right way to have a relationship, that people who don't follow that narrative or don't feel comfortable with it, like they still kind of do it. They still get married, but they don't really want to be exclusive, even if they love their partner. So they have to find kind of sneakier ways to get what they need, you know? And like, sure. not even to say they're like inherently bad people or anything, yeah. But it's like, fuck, like let's say I love my spouse, mm-hmm. but I really, really want to like do some sexual exploration, but there's no way I can have both without being rejected by my society, right? By my community, right? So I have to just try to get away with it if I can.
Yeah. So you know? They could hook up with somebody or find a sex worker maybe.
Yeah. Instead of like perhaps like...
But being dishonest about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like normalizing, like even like sitting down with your spouse and saying, hey, honey, I'm having these thoughts. I'm having these feelings. And this doesn't mean I love you any less. It doesn't mean that I want to end a relationship, which is usually the red flags that start popping in people's heads. But it's like, I just feel like I want some sexual variety in my life or some emotional variety. Could we maybe talk about ways to, you know, do this in a healthy way? If like we could normalize even having conversations like that, I think that that would just, you know, curb the heartbreak of cheating for one thing. And a lot of people who are interested in that kind of thing could probably fulfill those needs in a healthy, honest way.
It's possible.
Yeah.
I can also see that ending really poorly.
Oh,
like,
sure.
But like, I can see that just being like, you know, like I suppose part of the reason why one might be afraid of bringing that up is because then they might lose something that they have. That would be their fear, that this thing that they have with their partner, they might lose it entirely, that their partner might just say, well, fuck you then. Go find it. And you're not going to get it from me anymore.
Well, that to me just says something about the relationship in itself. Like if your partner reacts that way, I mean, if they really love you and if they really like hear you and see you and feel you, why should you be afraid to be honest about what you're feeling? Like if they really, really care about you and relate to you the way they say they do, I feel like they should at least be able to feel that, even if they disapprove, instead of not like, oh, well, this is how you feel. Well, then our relationship means nothing, has meant nothing. Goodbye.
I think it seems maybe a bit unethical to bring that up after like 15 years or something. Like,
I disagree.
You know, mm-hmm. you don't think because if you enter into an agreement that's a monogamous agreement, then I suppose if you're just bringing up a debate, maybe, or you're talking about how an inclination you might have.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. You could enter.
And you're saying, like, maybe we can negotiate the rules?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the thing. The thing is, like, people change. You know, people are malleable.
That's true.
It's like, a little too easy to be like, well, you agreed to this thing 20 years ago. You know, like, how dare you change your mind now? But, like, you change your mind about the kind of milk you drink. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you were 15, you're like, I'm never drinking soy milk. And then at 35, you're like, wait a minute. This might actually be for me. You know, I don't think that makes it like an unethical move by any means. And I think that like,
no, you're right about that.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that just because like people are so prone to, you know, change in general, like I think that's something to consider. Like, even the fact of like, you might be so head over heels in love with somebody 1 year and then 15 years later, your love might fade, honestly, you know, and it's tough to hear, but like, I think that's just the reality of it, you know, like nothing. You kind of hear that term, all's fair in love and war, right? Like, I mean, grain of truth to that, I suppose.
Yeah. Yeah.
Fuck war. But you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. I guess, I was just thinking of it. I was sort of trying to present another side. I really kind of fell flat, but like just maybe what's more true is just that, boy, that'd be difficult.
Like, absolutely.
Yeah. Like that would be difficult to have after like having, it's really kind of a treat to know that somebody's going to be there for you and all this stuff, but it isn't guaranteed, is it?
Exactly. Yeah, That's the thing. Like, I think people kind of like a draw of that is like the emotional security of it, you know, like I got somebody waiting at home for me and that is kind of nice, you know, long day's work. You want to go home and fall into the arms of your lover. It sounds amazing, That's the thing. Like, I think it can, perhaps this is too harsh a word, but I think it can be foolish to assume that that's always going to be there. Like, just like your favorite case of beer in the fridge. Like, you know, that shit's going to be there. You look forward to it, but it's a person, you know, they can change their mind at any time and you have to be ready for that.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And that is what you do to people you love, is you allow them to be themselves.
Exactly.
And yeah.
So if I brought that up to my partner in a monogamous, to wrap back to what you were saying, like if I brought this thing I was feeling up to my partner and their initial response was anger and rejection, that in and of itself would be like, oh, maybe this relationship was kind of crap in the first place. Or like maybe this wasn't like the love and the trust and the foundation I thought I had, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe in some way that reaction though might not be avoidable. You know, just because of emotions.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't necessarily mean that it is ideal or that it makes sense even.
Like, yeah.
But emotions happen to you, right?
Absolutely. And I can also see, like, let's say you were the recipient in that conversation, right?
That's what I'm kind of imagining. And in order to like sort of, play devil's advocate to this, I'm sort of imagining me.
Totally.
Yeah, yeah.
And I could see, that's the thing. Like, I also would not blame that partner for being emotional or even upset or angry, right? Because it's like, you did, because that's the thing. You did agree to be married monogamously, exclusively. That's the thing. And you can feel that way. And like, I wouldn't blame somebody if you're feeling hurt or rejected or like less important. But like, that's the other side of it. It's like, fucking, well, I mean, maybe this person's mind has changed and that doesn't necessarily mean they honestly love me any less or anything. It's just like, maybe they just need something else for fulfillment. And I think that relationships are a lot more complex, than just folks sometimes acknowledge.
They can be very complex.
I think we like to think they're pretty simple. There's like a basic set of rules you follow and it's good to go, but people are fucking people.
Yeah.
And they're nutty. You know what I'm saying?
Like, I think probably some of them are quite simple. You know, and some of them are quite complex, like we're saying. And we're talking about complex types of relationships. Like, that's like putting more pieces in it makes it more complex, like by definition, I'm pretty sure. So,
yeah, absolutely.
So, it's very cool. And in some sense, like, I could almost summarize that last piece of the conversation just by saying, well, the truth hurts, you know?
Yeah.
Like, the
honestly,
truth sometimes hurts. So,
and that's what it comes down to is like, do you want to be truthful and risk potentially hurting the feelings of someone you love? Or do you want to spare them that hurt, but lie to yourself?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And also when you hurt the feelings of the people you love, that can hurt you too.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
absolutely.
Like, there's.
But then again, if like, if your resolve is to like, let's say cheat on this person, like, well, I don't want them to know that I feel this way. So I'm going to be doing this shit behind their back. Well, is that really any better?
Right.
And I also know, like, I'm sure that some of these things are a lot easier for me to say because I'm very accustomed to this mindset, right? And it can be hard for me to put myself back in the place of, like, a monogamous person, you know?
Yeah. I'm trying to do it a little bit, present the other side.
Yeah. I appreciate it, too, honestly. Yeah. I think it's cool, like, if people at least try it, you know? Like, I would encourage people to at least give it a go.
I would say you tried it. You tried monogamy. So like,
yeah, I did. Exactly. Most of my life, I tried monogamy.
So that's to me all I could really say, you know?
Yeah.
And honestly, you can knock it if you've tried it. This isn't about knocking it. This whole show is not about knocking things, but honestly, if you've tried it, you can say why it's not for you. And you're entitled. It's just science really at that point. You've done the experiment. You've done the experimental group and the control group, and you can compare them.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So, I wouldn't, yeah, I'm a little bit hesitant to hear people's criticisms, especially if they want to go on and on about something that they haven't even done.
Right. So I'm sure you can imagine when people criticize non-monogamy and tell me why it's inherently flawed. I'm like, well, what the hell you know?
That's not my style at all.
Yeah.
No. Like,
yeah.
It's even if I thought it was trash, I wouldn't do that. I would still just try to show my interest. But, no, like I said, I think it's like art. I think it's really cool. It seems like a cool, like, experimental thing to do.
Yeah.
And it's with like a very intimate, like, emotional part of yourself, and physical too. Like, it's with your body. So it's like, to me, it's like taking some risks. It's a really daring thing to do. Probably just because it's not conventional. I guess if it were conventional, it'd just be like normal. It wouldn't be daring at
right.
all.
Right. It wouldn't be quite as
But I admire that, you know.
Yeah, thanks.
I guess I was going to ask about kids.
Yeah.
So what about having kids? Is that anything you want to do?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
I decided a while ago that I'm not interested in, like, for sure having or raising children, and also not like having like a family, like kind of just like a domestic situation, I suppose. Like, I'm very interested in not staying in the same place for too long. I like to travel a lot. I love my private time. I love time with myself. I love the spontaneity or impulsivity of like, oh, let's get up and do this today. You know, like, I don't know what I'm going to do today. Or like, my free time, I can go down and see some friends or whatever, you know, like, definitely not into the idea of dedicating my life to raising kids or fostering like a domestic situation. And mm-hmm.
What if then somebody wanted to have your babies and you didn't have to? You didn't have to be part of the domestic situation.
You're talking like someone's like, I want to have your baby, and then I knock them up and then they just raise the kid on their own?
Or with someone else, or in any way.
Maybe. I mean, if they were really interested in that, I guess like we could talk about it. And if it all seemed right. If I were to do that, I'd want to make sure this was like someone who I trusted, or like, I'm like,
of course,
you know, if I'm going to give you my seed, I want to make sure you're going to treat the little kiddo okay.
Yeah. And that they're not going to try to rope you in after that. They'd have to honor their word about it.
I'd be like motherfucking like writing up a contract, you know,
yeah,
like we'd be signing contracts at that point.
I'm kind of trying to superimpose an attitude about relationship anarchy. Am I saying that right?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to superimpose that onto like maybe raising children. So like, someone wants to, they want, she wants you to knock her up, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, but what is after that is freedom for you.
Yeah.
So like, you could come around or not, but you don't have exclusive rights to be the kid's dad.
Right.
So, do you know what I'm saying? I'm kind of just superimposing the same values.
I'm biologically this child's father,
yeah,
right? But like, I mean, that'd be fine with that. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I don't really have an interest in making that happen, but if somebody, I don't know, really admired me and they were like, I want to just have a little Seth in the world or something.
Mm-hmm,
and me and my partner will take care of them in like a loving home. It's like safe.
Yeah.
Then Sure, as long as the stars aligned, you know what I'm saying? Like
partner or partners, right?
Yeah, but it would have to be a very specific situation. I don't see that happening, honestly. But I mean, if it came up, I would at least explore it, the idea, you know? But I have absolutely no interest in raising children on my own. I just, the idea of my life being dedicated to children sounds like literal hell on earth. Actual hell on earth. And like, but I mean, kids are cool. Like I like spending like in small doses. It's fun to like, you know, joke around with them or like I'd babysit or like, you know, I get the impression probably my siblings will have kids at some point. And I being a fun uncle would be rad, you know, watching them for the weekend, showing them rock records and shit. But then like knowing Monday morning, I can just drop them back off, you know, or something like that'd be cool. And I also like the idea of like trying to put like a positive influence on like the youth, you know, like maybe like, hey, I can like, show you some cool stuff, tell you some cool stuff, like let you know what's kind of like, you know, like nonsense or whatever and like stuff like that.
Yeah, but, a little guidance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I don't want to have to be doing that every fucking day of the week.
Yeah.
You know?
And to be legally responsible and to be held to sort of held to task for everything that the child does. It's a very big responsibility. Like many things on the show, it's just not for everyone. So
yeah.
I think I definitely want to do an episode about not having children or several. I do sort of see this as like you have a story about being non-monogamous. Other people have other stories. So like I'd like to get more angles on the same thing as well as so. Different people can answer the same question in different ways.
And even to like rope it back into like non-monogamy, I mean, there's still like successful, healthy homes that have like, that consist of like polycules or like non-monogamous folks where like there's like primary parents, but it could be almost like multiple partners raising this child in agreement, right? And like, is copacetic the word? Maybe.
Sure.
But like, just like a healthy agreed upon like situation, you know, where like, again, in like traditional Western values, it's thought of like, you know, one man, one woman is the ideal situation to raise
a
child.
You're talking more about like an extended family.
Yeah, honestly. And I mean, that is a thing that exists in the non-monogamous community. You know, people do raise kids. They do have kids with one another. Like, I can't think of names off the top of my head, but like there's just fringe people I know of even in Minneapolis that do that, you know? And I think that's kind of a beautiful thing. So that's a point I wanted to say was that I don't think that just because I feel this way, non-monogamy and being childless don't inherently go hand in hand.
Right, right. Yeah. And that it would be interesting to talk to somebody who is doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Just to kind of see, it's almost kind of like, it reminds me of that takes a village to raise a child kind of thing.
Sure.
I could see that being like a very healthy situation where they almost have like their primary parents, but there's also other healthy influences, like around, like, you know, also like nurturing and influencing this child.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, you know, and like, as I was saying about sort of the stability that I have with monogamy and about how I see that as just sort of advantageous to my life, it's a very sterile, non-romantic thing to say, but it's given us a strategic advantage in navigating life,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
Why not have a whole organization? I mean, imagine what you could do with that.
Yeah,
right?
Totally.
Yeah, yeah. And to raise a child or to do whatever this kind of stuff you got to do to get through life. Yeah, I mean, how awesome would it be like if my car broke down and there were 15 people I could call instead of one? You know?
Yeah, like, yeah, yeah. Seriously.
Like, and hope she answers her phone.
No, honestly, man. Or like, think about like, you know, you and one of your partners want to get away for like a half a week or a weekend or something. Like, can my other partner watch this child? You know, like while we're gone or something like that. It's like,
why not?
The limit does not exist.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Yeah, and get by mail and take out the garbage and do all the things that I would do for you. You know, like
straight up.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. It's pretty rock and roll, if you ask me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it sounds like I say, there's a lot of possibilities and, thanks for talking to me and good luck with everything and, exploring all this and growing and embracing all the things that happened to you in your relationships.
Thank you so much, man. Yeah. Thanks for having me. It's really nice to just like get a second to like talk about this, you know, with somebody who wants to listen. And hopefully if there's folks out there that are thinking maybe non-monogamy is kind of the life for them and maybe some of this could help them a little bit. That'd be cool, you know?
Maybe.
Yeah, I guess we'll see.
All right. Thank you, Seth.
Thank you, man.
And thanks to everyone who's been contributing to this podcast. You make the show possible. If you liked today's episode and you can find it in your heart to part with a few dollars, it would help us a lot. You can do that at idontdothatpodcast.com/give. Monthly memberships start at $4. Members get the podcast episodes the day before they come out. You also get access to exclusive content such as music and comedy, and opportunities to get involved such as a chance to interview me, Ocho, about things I don't do. And I don't do a lot of stuff. I don't play sports, I don't have kids, I don't watch sports, I don't drink alcohol, I don't hold babies, I don't even smoke weed, I don't ride on motorcycles, I don't play video games, I don't do family entertainment either. What the fuck? Don't you kind of wonder about that? Do you want to have a conversation with me about it? Sign up for a membership at idontdothatpodcast.com/give and then ask me how. If you don't want to get a membership, you can make a one-time donation in the amount of your choosing. You can also find some really sweet merch. That is all at idontdothatpodcast.com/give. Thank you, Seth. If you're into some grungy, surfy, cowpunk, alternative rock, you can check out Seth's band, Lavender Daughter, on streaming services now or on tour in the near future. Seth also plays in Minneapolis, St. Paul, in pop punk sensation Oyster Boy. My name is Ocho. I'm your host, chief engineer and producer. I also composed and performed the theme song. Shout out always to our sponsor, Anders, with Primetime Web. Thanks to all of you for all that you do and for all that you don't do. I will talk to you again if I'm lucky. I don't do that.